Okey diyoruz. En son ne oldu? Meyer geldiydi zaten. Chronicler'a kendi vasiyeti gibi bir şeyini yazdıracak ama şey istiyor. Özel alan istiyor. Privacy istiyor. Kvot'la siz şöyle bir yarım saatliğine uzaklarda takılsanız iyi olur dedi. Kvot'la tamam yaptı. Bunlar üst kata çıktılar. Orada Kvot'un odasına girdiler. Dedi, ne yapsak ne yapsak bir yarım saati nasıl geçirsek diye düşünüyorlardı. Bas dedi ki ders yapalım. Kıvat dedi ki işte tam yapalım. İşte senin şu kitabı okuman lazım. İşte senin dersin o kitabı okumak. Diye Think to Read bir şey değişik bir kitap adı söyleyip duruyordu zaten. Tekrar onu söyledi. Bas dedi ki bak Kıvat dersleri seviyorum. Hani Reş dedi Kıvat demedi de. Hani dersleri seviyorum ama kitap dersini sevmiyorum. Bana başka türlü bir ders ver. Kvot da güldü falan. Tamam bekle bir düşüneyim dedi. Odaya bakmaya başladı. Sonra gözleri bir şeyde kaldı, kısıldı. Bana benim yatağımın ucundaki sandığı nasıl açacağını söyle. Açmak istesen nasıl davranırdın onu söyle dedi. En baş öğrendik ki işte bastığın o sandığa dair tahminlerini söylemeden önce, yok sandığı açmaya dair tahminlerini söylemeden önce sandığın nasıl bir sandık olduğuna dair tahminlerini söylemeye başladı. Öyle bir odundan yapılmış ki sandık yanmıyor ve sanırım kırılmıyor da bir şekilde. Hatta ne oluyor bas bir ara kılıç gibi bir şeyle saldırıyor ama böyle taşa çarpıyormuş gibi bir tepkisi oluyor. Kılıcın hani kesinlikle oduna girmiyor. Çentik falan açmıyor. Öte yandan yanmayan bir odundan olduğunu biliyoruz. Artı çok ağır. Kvot'la Bast taşınırken aşırı zorlanmışlar. Bast diyor ki ben onu yakardım diyor. Bir tane fırın gibi bir şey götürüp. Ama bunu yakabilecek kadar büyük bir fırın bu köyde yok. Öte türlü bir fırın bulsak bile bunu Kvot diyor sanırım. Öte türlü bir fırın bulsak bile diye. İşte sandığı yakmak demek onun içindekileri yakmak demek anlamına gelebilir ki işte sen onun içindekileri almak isteyen biriymiş değilsen bunu yapamamış olursun diyor. Bas diyor ki asitle anahtarları çözmeye çalışırdım. Kod diyor ki evet asitle iyi iş görebilirsin ama asit işte sandığın içindeki şeylere zarar verebilir. Aynı ateş muhabbetinde olduğu gibi onun için asit de kullanılamaz gibi bir şey diyor. Bas ne yapıyor sonra kırmaya ha böyle büyü yapmaya çalışıyor ama yapamıyor ki zaten copper bir lock var orada. Copper neydi? Bakalım ben bakırdı sanki. Minecraft'tan bunu bilmem gerekmiyor mu? Aslında aynen bakır. Büyü bakıra işlemiyor. Hatta Elodin böyle kendi odasından bir kere daha tabolinde Great gibi çıkmak isterken çıkamadıydı. Sonra fark ettiydi ki bakır karıştırmışlar falan. Ondan sonra yeni bir isim söylemesi gerektiği gibi bir şey oldu falan. Neyse hani büyük ihtimal basma o ara yaptığı büyüyü o bakır engelliyor. Ama ben sadece kendi adıma o bakırın engellediğini düşünmüyorum. Böyle anti karşı büyüler falan da var. Birkaç tane orada ama nasıl bir şey? I have no idea. Bunun dışında başka bir şey var mı düşünüp geliyorum. Neyse aşağı yukarı bunları denedi. Bast en son pes etti ama Kvot buna dedi ki işte yine de iyi iş çıkardın Bast. Hani ben yapacak olsam tıpatıp senin dediklerini yapardım. Ben de hani daha iyi bir seçenek varsa bile ben bilmiyorum ha getirdi lafı. Sonra aşağıdan Mir bağırdı tamamen işin bitti gelip işinize devam edebilirsiniz gibisinden. Bunlar aşağı ineceklerdi. Bast tam kapıdan çıkarken Kvot'un masasındaki kağıtlardan birini düşürdü. Tam eğri bunu alacakken Kvot buna dur al, bırak orada kalsın yaptı. Bast da dönüp gitti. Sonra Kvot da kapıyı arkasından kapatıp gitti. Yani yazdığı şeyi tutup masaya koyacak kadar bile değerli olmadığını düşündüğünü görüyoruz sanırım. Okey. Bunun dışında başka bir şey var mı? Başlamadan önce düşünüp geliyorum. Okay, chapter 72, horses. Several days after Dana and I had our moonlit stroll in the garden, I finished a song for Meluven called Nothing But Roses. Damir specifically requested it, and I had leapt to the project with a will, knowing that Dana would love herself sick when I played it for her. Mesela Mayer's song into an envelope and looked at the clock. I thought I'd be busy the entire night finishing it, but it had come with surprising ease. Consequently, I had the rest of the evening free. It was late, but not terribly late. Not late for Sunday night in a lively city, lively city like Severin. Perhaps not too late to find Dana. I threw on a set of fresh clothes and hurried out of the estate. Since the money in my purse came from selling pieces of Carl Dickus's equipment and playing cards with nobles who knew more about fashion than statistics, I paid the full bid for the horse lifts, then jogged the half mile to Neville Street. Ha, şu an öyle bir konumda ki resmen Mayer'dan para almadan hayatta kalabilecek parayı kendine bulabiliyor gibi. Tamam, hani Kadikus'un eşyalarını satması yine şey, ama öte yandan zengin insanlarla oturup kart oynayıp onlardan para kazanması falan okey diyoruz. A slow to a walk. Bu arada aklıma gelmişken söyleyeyim. Kumar oynanan hiçbir fantastik edebiyat eserinde gördüm, hatırlamıyorum. Başka Harry Potter'da yok. Yüzüklerin Efendisi'nde yok. Benim bildiğim Game of Thrones'da varmıştır. Aklıma gelmiyor ama varmıştır diyoruz. Bir kere Tyrion kesin oynuyormuştur da hatırlamıyorum. Yer denizde yok. Dalo'da varsa ufaktan var. Emin değilim. Dalo ve Game of Thrones'a emin değilim. Okey, ama burada düpedüz var. Kvot'un kendisi oynuyor. I slowed to a walk for the last several blocks. Enthusiasm is flattering, but I didn't want to arrive at Dana's inn panting and sweating like a lettered horse. I wasn't surprised when I didn't find her at the Four Tapers. Dana wasn't the sort to sit and twiddle her thumbs just because I was busy, but the two of us had spent the better part of a month exploring the city together, and I had a few good guesses as to where I might find her. 5 minutes later, I spotted her. She was moving through the crowded street with a definite purpose, walking as if she had somewhere important to be. I started to make my way towards her, then hesitated. Where would she be going so purposefully alone, so late at night? Patronıyla buluşmaya olabilir mi kanka diyoruz. She was going to meet her patron. I wish I could say I agonized before I decided to follow her, but I really didn't. The temptation of finally learning the identity of her patron was simply too strong. Kedios, yemin ettiğin elinin üstüne amına koyayım. Müzik yapamıyorsun, büyü yapamıyorsun. Şu an gerçek zamanda bununla bir alakası olma ihtimali yüksek diyoruz. So I put up the hood of my cloak and began to ghost through the crowd behind Dana. It's remarkably easy if you have a little practice. I used to make a game of it in Tarbiyen, seeing how far I could follow someone without being seen. It helped that Dana wasn't a fool and stayed in the good parts of the city where the streets were busy, and in the dim light my cloak looked a nondescript black. I followed her for half an hour. We passed cart vendors selling chestnuts and greasy meat pies. Guards mingled with the crowd, and the streets were bright with scattered street lights and lanterns hung outside the doors of inns. An occasional out-at-the-heels musician played with his hat in front of him, and once we passed a troupe of mummers acting out a play in a small cobblestone square. Then I turned and left the better streets behind. Soon there were fewer lights and tipsy revelers. The musicians gave way to beggars who called out or clutched at your clothes as you walked by. Lamplight still poured through the windows of nearby pubs and inns, but the street was no longer bustling. People clustered in twos or threes, women wearing corsets and men with hard eyes. Korse dediğimiz olay tam olarak ne oluyor? Bunu giymek neden şimdi fakirlik göstergesi? Abomas tightly fitting undergarment extending from below to chest, below the chest to the hips, worn to shape the figure. Okay, bu Fransa'da, İngiltere'de falan bir dönem var. Mozart'ın dönemi. O dönemde insanlar giyiyorlardı sırf kadınlar böyle özellikle dik durmaktan başka bir şey yapamasınlar gibisinden. Şunun bir resmini bulup geleceğim. Okey, buradan gördüğümden bir genel evin önünden geçiyor gibi düşünesim geldi. Ama öte yandan not necessarily, yani ne bileyim. Şunu görünce mesela not necessarily bence ne anlama geliyor emin değilim. Okey. These trees weren't dangerous, strictly speaking. Or rather, they were dangerous in a broken glass sort of way. Broken glass won't go out of its way to hurt you. You can even touch it if you're careful. Some trees are dangerous as prodding dogs, where no amount of care will keep you safe. Bir kitap okuduydum. Tepe taklak tersine dünya okuluydu sanırım. Yanlış hatırlamıyorsam oranın köylerinde bile üç farklı aşaması var. Yok, oranın gettolarının bile üç farklı aşaması vardı. İşte böyle çok fakir olup aynı anda birkaç işte çalışanların yaşadığı getto. Hani bu tarz insanlar etraflarına saldırmıyorlar. Gertrude o kadar da güvensiz değiller. Onun bir seviye altı işin içine drug girmiş, millet sokaklara dökülmüş, direkt çaresizler ama onun da bir level altı var. Oraya resmen böyle şey yani. Benim bir kere bir arkadaşım anlattıydı. Arkadaşım Brezilya'ya gittiydi. Bunlar bu tarz bir sokağın oraya geliyorlar. Sokağın başındaki bir adam geliyor bunlara. Dönün, buraya giremezsiniz. Uzaklaşın buradan falan yapıyor. Ve bir şekilde onlar öyle bir hissetmişlerdi ki o adamın söylediklerini falan baya bir işte motherfucker bir ghetto oldu anlaşılmıştı diyeyim. Neyse o geldi aklıma. Şu an bu ilk level'dan bahsediyor. Hani o İspanya'da 3 level, İspanya'da değil, Brezilya'da 3 level olan o tehlike seviyesinin ilk en güvenli olan level bu. Okay. I was beginning to get nervous when I saw Dana stop suddenly at the mouth of a shadowed alley. She craned her neck for a moment, as if listening to something. Then after peering into the dark, she darted inside. Was this where she was meeting her patron? Was she taking a shortcut to a different street? Or was she simply following her paranoid patron's instructions to make sure no one followed her? I began to curse under my breath. If I followed her into the alley and she saw me, it would be obvious I'd been trailing her. But if I didn't follow her, I'd lose her. And while this wasn't a truly dangerous part of the city, I didn't want to leave her walking alone so late at night. So I scanned the nearby buildings and spotted one fronted with crumbling field stone. After a quick glance around, I climbed the face of it quick as a squirrel, another useful skill from my misspent youth. Once I was on the roof, it was a simple matter to run over the tops of several other buildings. Then slink into the shadow of a chimney before peering down into the alley. There was a sliver of moon overhead, and I expected to see Dana striding quickly along her shortcut or having a hushed and hidden meeting with her dodgy patron. But what I saw was nothing of the sort. Dim lamp light from an upstairs window showed a woman splayed out motionless on the ground. My heart thudded hard for several beats until I realized it wasn't Dana. Dana was dressed in shirt and pants. This woman's white dress was crumpled around her, her bare legs pale against the dark stone of the street. My eyes darted around until I saw Then outside the window's light. She stood close to a broad-shouldered man with moonlight shining on his bald head. Was she embracing him? Was this her patron? Finally, my eyes adjusted enough that I could see the truth. The two were standing very close and still, but she wasn't holding him. She had one hand hard against his neck, and I saw white moonlight glitter on metal there, like a distant star. The woman on the ground started to stir, and then I called out to her. The woman climbed unsteadily to her feet, staggering a bit as she stepped on her own dress and edged slowly past them, keeping close to the wall as she made her way to the mouth of the alley. Once the woman was behind her, then I said something else. I was too far away to make out any of the words, but her voice was hard and angry enough to raise the hair on the back of my arms. Then I stepped away from the man and he backed away, one hand going to the side of his throat. He began to curse her viciously, spitting and making grasping motions with his free hand. His voice was louder than hers, but slurred enough that I couldn't make out much of what he said, though I did identify the word whore several times. But for all his talk, okay, enteresan bir nokta, hani bitch de küfür, whore da küfür, ama whore, birisine sinirlendiğiniz zaman whore diyorsunuz. Hani sanki bitch'i, böyle bitch artık orospuluk anlamından çıkıp direkt böyle sorun çıkaran kadın gibi bir anlama gelmiş de bir kadın işte ekstradan gıcık davranırsa falan yürü bitch falan tarzı bir kullanıma gelmiş gibi. Ama öte yandan whore diyorsa kesinlikle bir sexual tarafı var whore kelimesinin. Kesinlikle bir aldatma vari, bir ihtimal işin içinde var bence. Okey. Güzel bir nokta. Öyle. But for all his talk, he didn't come anywhere close to within arm's reach of her. Then I simply stood facing him, her feet set squarely on the ground. She had a knife low in front of her, tilted at an angle. Her posture was almost casual, almost. After cursing for a minute or so, the man took half a shuffling step forward, shaking a fist. Then I said something and made a short, sharp gesture with the knife towards the man's groin. Silence filled the alley and the man's shoulders shifted a bit. Then I made the gesture again and the man began to curse more softly, turning away and walking down the alley. His hands still pressed to the side of his neck. Then I watched him go, then relaxed and slid the knife carefully into her pocket. She turned and walked to the mouth of the alleyway. I scurried to the front of the building. On the street below, I saw Dana and the other woman standing under a street lamp. Hani böyle çok alışmışım diyaloglardaki kelime sayısına bakmaya falan. O kadar hızlı okuyoruz ki şu an böyle bir şey oldum. Afalladım çünkü okuyup devam et. Oku devam et gibi gidiyor. Okay diyoruz. In a better light, I saw the woman was much younger than I thought, just a slip of a girl, her shoulders heaving with sobs. Then I rubbed her back in small circles, and the girl slowly calmed down. After a moment, they began walking down the street. I hurried back to the alley where I had spotted an old iron drain pipe, a relatively easy way to get back down onto the street. But even so, it cost me 2 long minutes and most of the skin off my knuckles to get cobblestones back under my feet. Only through a pure effort of will did I keep myself from running out of the alley to catch up with Dana and the girl. The last thing I wanted was for Dana to discover I'd been following her. Okay. Hani şöyle bunu Joe'yu hatırlıyorum. Yani John'un Kvot'un Dana'yı takip etmesi hakkında ne kadar sinirlendiğini diyeyim. Hani ben o kadar sinirlenmeyebiliyorum çünkü işin içinde Dana'nın Patron'un kim olduğunu öğrenme tarafı var. Dana cidden bir tehlike de olabilir. Ve Dana apparently kendi ağzından söyleyemiyor. Ama Claude iyi bir şekilde saklanarak Dana'yı takip ederse ve Patron'u görebilirse falan Dana'ya gayet artı olabilme ihtimali var bu işin. Ki bu esnada Claude Cinder olduğunu bilmiyor Dana'nın Patron'ının. O manyak. Bir kere Cinder olduğunu biz biliyoruz. Claude'un Dana'yı takip etmesi şu an doğru. Claude bilmiyor Cinder olduğunu onun belki. Ama Cinder gibi bir insan olmasından şüpheleniyor ki Cinder diyoruz. Bu açıdan bence Claude'un Dana'yı takip etmesi doğru. Çünkü Dana'yı seviyor ve sevdiği bir insanı korumak istiyor ve Dana Claude'a kendi ağzından söyleyemiyor. Çünkü bir şekilde Cinder Dana'yı falakaya yatırsa da işte Claude'a söyledim mi söylemedim mi söyle bana yapsa Dana'nın onca işkenceden sonra pes etme ihtimali var. Ya da böyle belki bir büyü gibi bir şey var. O büyüyü bir insana yapınca direkt gerçekleri söylemeye başlıyor. Ki eğer Claude Dana fark etmeden Dana'yı takip edip Dana'nın Patreon'ını görürse Dana ben Claude'a söylemedim yemin ederim diye yemin ettiği zaman dürüst olabilir diyoruz. Bunlar bence mantıklı ihtimaller. Bu açıdan çok kızasım gelmiyor benim. Şu an kvota öyle. Luckily, they were moving very fast. And I caught sight of them easily. Then I led the girl back to the nicer part of the city. Then took her into a respectable looking inn with a painted rooster on the sign. I stood outside for a minute, peering at the layout of the inn through one of the windows. And I settled my hood more firmly over my face, walked casually around the back portion of the inn, and slid into a seat onto the other side of a dividing wall, just around the corner from Dana and the young girl. If I'd wanted to, I could have leaned forward to peer at their table, but as it was, neither one of us could see the other. The tap room was mostly empty, and a serving girl came up to me almost as soon as I took my seat. She eyed the rich fabric of my cloak and smiled. What can I get you? I eyed the impressive array of polished glass behind the bar. I motioned the serving girl closer and spoke softly, with a rasp in my throat, as if I were recovering from the crab cough. I take a tumble of your best whiskey, I said, and a glass of fine Feller'ın red. She nodded and left. I turned my finely tuned eavesdropper's ears to the next table. Okay, bunun böyle bir kulağı vardı şimdi hatırladım. Belki de indeyken dışarıdan gelenleri hemen duyup böyle direkt masaya kart dağıtıydı kroniklere falan. Bu tarz bir şey diyoruz. Ears to the next table. Your accent, I heard Dana say. Where are you from? There was a pause and a murmur as the girl spoke. Since she was facing away from me, I couldn't hear what she said. That's in the Western Ferrell, isn't it? Dana asked. You're a long way from home. There was murmuring from the girl, then a long pause where I couldn't hear anything. Okay, güzel nokta aklıma geldi. Dana da David'i ikisi de kadınları şampiyonu gibi bir şey. Tanımadıkları kadınları korumak için risk alıyorlar. Hatta Dana'nınki daha büyük bir risk. Çünkü Dana Devi kadar yerleşik ve güçlü birisi değil. Öyle. Gayet takdir ediyor. I couldn't tell if she'd stopped talking or if she was speaking too quietly for me to hear. I fought the urge to lean forward and peer at their table. Then a murmuring came back, very soft. I know he said he loved you, Dana said, her voice gentle. They all say that. The serving girl set a tall wine glass in front of me and handed me my tumble to bits. Merciful Tehlü, with prices like that, no wonder the place was nearly empty. I tossed back the whiskey in a single swallow, fighting the urge to cough as it burned down my throat. Then I drew a full silver round out of my purse, set the heavy coin on the table, and put the empty tumble down over the top of it. motioned the serving girl close again. I have a proposal for you, I said quietly. Right now, I want nothing more than to sit here quietly, drink my wine, and think my thoughts. I tapped the overturned tumbler with the coin underneath. If I'm allowed to do this without interruption, all of this, that's the cost of my drinks, is yours. Her eyes went a little wide at this, darting down to the coin again. But if anyone comes over to bother me, even in a helpful way, even to ask if I would like anything to drink, I will simply pay and leave. I looked up at her. Can you help me get a little privacy tonight? She nodded eagerly. Thank you, I said. She hurried away and went immediately to another woman standing behind the bar, making a few gestures in my direction. I relaxed a bit, reasonably certain they wouldn't be drawing any attention to me. I sipped my wine and listened. Does your father do? Then I asked. I recognized the pitch of her voice. It was the same low, gentle tone my father had used when talking to skittish animals. A tone designed to calm someone and set them at their ease. The girl murmured and then I responded, "It's a fine job. What are you doing here then?" Another murmur. "Got handsy, did he?" Then I said matter-of-factly, "Well, that's the nature of eldest sons." The girl spoke up again, this time with some fire in her voice, but still couldn't make out any of the words. I buffed the surface of my wine glass a little with the edge of my cloak, then tipped it out and away from me a bit. The wine was so deep a red that it was almost black. It made the side of the glass act like a mirror. What a wonderful mirror, but I could see tiny shapes at the table around the corner. I heard then a sigh, cutting off the low murmur of the girl's voice. Let me guess, then I said, sounding exasperated. You stole the silver or something similar, then ran off to the city. The small reflection of the girl just sat there, but it wasn't like you thought it would be, was it? Then I said, more gently this time. I could see the girl's shoulders begin to shake and heard a series of faint, heartbreaking sobs. I looked away from the wine glass and set it back on the table. Here, there was a sound of a glass being knocked onto the table. Drink that, then I said. It'll help a bit. Not a lot, but a bit. The sobbing stopped. The girl gave a surprised cough, choking a little. You poor silly thing, then I said softly. Meeting you is worse than looking in a mirror. For the first time, the girl spoke loudly enough for me to hear her. I thought, if he's going to take me anyway and get it for free, I might as well go somewhere I can pick and choose and get paid for it. Her voice trailed off until I couldn't make out any words, leaving only the low rise and fall of her muffled voice. The tenpenny king then interrupted incredulously, her tone more venomous than anything I'd ever heard from her before. Kissed and creel, I hate that goddamn play. Modern fairy story trash. The world doesn't work like that. But the girl began, then I cut her off. There is no young prince out there dressed in rags and waiting to save you. Even if there were, where would you be? You'd be like a dog he'd found in the gutter, he'd own you. After he took you home, who would save you from him? A piece of silence of çok ağırdı bu yalnız. Hani kesinlikle güvenmiyor kimseye. Bu açıdan Kvot aşık Dena'ya ve Kvot'u ne kadar geriden hafiften alttan aldığını biliyoruz. Artı direkt. Şu an yaptığı şey dışında. A piece of silence. The girl coughed again, but only a little. So what are we going to do with you? With you, then I said. The girl sniffed and said something. If you could take care of yourself, you wouldn't be sitting here, then I said, a murmur. It's an option, then I said. You take half of what you make, but that's better than getting nothing and having your throat slit on top of it. I'm guessing you figured that out yourself tonight. There was a sound of cloth on cloth. I tilted my wine glass to get a look, but all I saw was them making some indistinct motion. Let's see what we have here, she said. Then there came the familiar clatter of coins on a table. The girl made an aid murmur. No, I am not, then I said. It's not so much when it's all your money in the world. You should know by now how expensive it is to make your own way in the city. A murmur that rose at the end, a question. I heard, then I drew a breath, then let it out again slowly. Because someone helped me once when I needed it, she said, and because if you don't get some help, you'll be dead in a span of days. Take it from someone who's made her own share of bad decisions. There was a sound of coins sliding on the table. Okay, then I said, first option, we get you apprenticed up. You're a little old and it will cost, but we could do it. Nothing fancy, weaving, cobbling. They work you hard, but you'd have your room and board and you'd learn a trade. A questioning murmur with your accent and asked artfully, can you curl a lady's hair, paint her face, mend her dress, tatty lace? A pause, no. You don't have the training to be a maid servant, and I wouldn't know who to bribe. The sound of coins being gathered together, option two. Then I said, we get you a room until that blue eyes is gone. Coin sliding, then buy you a seat on a coach back home. More coins, you've been gone a month. That's a perfect amount of time for some serious worry to set in. When you come home, they'll just be happy you're alive. Murmur, tell them whatever you like, then I said, but if you got half a brain in your head, you'll make it sensible. Nobody's going to believe you met some prince who sent you home. A murmur so soft, I could hardly hear it. Of course, it will be hard, you silly little bint, then I said sharply. You hold it over your head for the rest of your life. Folk will whisper when you walk by on the street. It will be hard to find a husband. You'll lose friends, but that's the price you'll have to pay if you want to have anything like your normal life back again. The coins clinked as they were gathered together again. Third option. If you're certain you want to make a go of whoring, you can arrange it so you don't end up dead in a ditch. You got a nice face, but you'll need proper clothes. Coin sliding. And someone to teach you manners, more coins, and someone else to get rid of that accent of yours, coins again. Murmur, because it's the only sensible way to do it, then I said flatly. Another murmur, then I gave a tight, irritated sigh. Okay, your father's table master, right? Think about the different horses that Baron owns. Plow horses, carriage horses, hunting horses. Exactly, murmur, exactly, then I said. So if you had to pick, what sort of horse would you want to be? A plow horse works hard, but does it get the best stall, the best feed? Murmur, that's right. That goes to the fancy horses. They get petted and fed and only have to work when there is a parade or someone goes hunting. Then I continued. So if you're going to be a whore, you do it smart. You don't want to be some dockside tramp. You want to be a duchess. You want men to court you, send you gifts. Murmur, yes, gifts. If they pay, they feel like they own you. You saw how that turned out tonight. You can keep your accent and the global dice and have sailors pull you for a penny a throw. Or you can learn some manners, get your hair done, and start entertaining gentlemen callers. If you're interesting, hani bu şurada dediği şey Dana'nın kendi yaptığı şey değil mi? Or you can learn some manners, get your hair done, Start Entertaining Gentlemen Callers. Bir sürü değişik uşakların hayatına giriyor. Uşak dediğim koca koca adamlar. Bunlardan bazıları ben de bunlarla seks yapıyor mu bilmiyorum. Bence yapıyor olması mantıklıydı. Cinder bunun Patreon olana kadar. Çünkü başka türlü nasıl hayatta kalıyordu. Ama öte yandan yapmıyor. Sadece onlarla oturup muhabbet ediyor olabilir ve kendisine aşık ediyor bunlar. Dana'ya kolye falan alıyorlar. Bilmiyorum. Bence yapıyor ama hiç yapıyor gibi de bir hava vermiyor. Sanki bir şekilde bakiriyeti aşırı önemliymiş. Onun ne olursa olsun kaybedemem gibi bir havası varmış gibi hissediyorum. Emin değilim. If you're interesting and pretty and you know how to listen, men will desire your company. They want to take you dancing as much as take you to bed. Then you had a control. Not sure. Bu Dana'nın yaptığı bu. Nobody makes a duchess pay for her room in advance. Nobody bends a duchess over a barrel in an alley, then kicks out her teeth once he's had his fun. Murmur, no, then I said, her voice scream. There was a sound of coins being clinked softly into a purse. Don't lie to yourself. Even the fanciest horse is still a horse. That means sooner or later you're going to get ridden. Equationing murmur, then you leave, then I said, they want more than you're willing to give, that's the only way. You leave quick and quiet in the night. But if you do, you'll burn your bridges. That's the price you pay. A hesitant murmur. I can't tell you that, then I said. You need to decide what you want for yourself. You want to go home? There is a price. You want control over your life? There is a price. You want the freedom to say no? There is a price. There is always a price. There was a sound of a chair being pushed away from a table, and I pressed myself back against the wall as I heard the two of them stand up. It's something everyone has to figure out on their own, Dana said, her voice growing more distant. What do you want more than anything else? What do you want so badly you pay anything to get it? I sat for a long time after they left, trying to drink my wine. Chapter 73, Blood and Ink. Kapatmadan önce diyecek bir şey var mı düşünüp geliyorum. Nope, hadi görüşürüz.